Good morning. Today I'm going to discuss with you the renal allograft pathology. And I'm going to stress upon the highlights on the last report of the Banff 2017. So to start with, renal biopsy after kidney transplantation helps us a lot to reach the final diagnosis and to give us prognostic value. So the outline of my presentation, I'll start with the introduction about the adequacy of biopsy specimen, then acute T-cell mediated rejection, how to diagnose, and I think for acute T-cell mediated rejection, no change in the current Banff in comparison to the old ones. Active antibody mediated rejection, there is major changes in the in some points I'm going to mention. Chronic antibody mediated rejection, chronic active T-cell mediated rejection, the nephrocysts of cyclosporin and other diagnoses, and at the end I'll reach my conclusion. So let's start with what's meant by adequate biopsy. For biopsy to be adequate, the biopsy should be representative. So it contains the two cores of cortex or two separate cortical areas, more than 10 glomeruli and more than two arteries, because suppose that we have many glomeruli, but there is no arteries, so we may miss vasculitis diagnosis. Biopsy is considered minimal if it includes seven glomeruli and one artery. Slide preparations, multiple sequential sections, three slides hematoxylin and leucine, three slides periodic acid chef or silver, and one slide for trichrome. All these are the criteria for the biopsy sample and interpretation. The new Banff 2017 is published within the current issue of the American Journal of Transplantation this month, and as you see in the title here, there is a revised diagnostic criteria for chronic active T-cell mediated rejection. So this is a new addition, some modification in the diagnosis of antibody mediated rejection, especially for the surrogate endpoints for donor-specific antibodies by addressing the molecular transcripts within the histology and looking at the endpoints. So I'm going to start with T-cell mediated rejection. To diagnose T-cell mediated rejection, we should evaluate the core for three letters in the absence of the letters of antibody mediated rejection. What are the letters denoting T-cell mediated rejection? The letters are I, T, and V. What's meant by I means interstitial inflammation. We score interstitial inflammation either I0, this means that less than 10% of the interstitium is inflamed, I1 between 10% to 25%, I2 between 25% and 50%, and I3 above the more than 50% of the interstitium is inflamed. If we look here, this is inflammation within the interstitium, so it is I1. It is approximate just above 10%, and this is I2 because it is more than it is between 25% and 50%, and this is I3. All the interstitium is affected by inflammatory process. So this is regarding I. Regarding T, here, to document tubulitis, we should look at the stains that characterize the basement membrane. Here you can see this is the basement membrane of the tubular. This is a cross section of tubular of tubule. This is a tubular basement membrane, and what do you see? This is the regular nuclei of the renal tubules, but here this is the small nucleus of inflammatory cells, lymphocytes, invading the tubular basement membrane inside the tubular cell. So this is tubulitis. The importance of pus stain, it delineates the basement membrane, because if there is no delineation, we can imagine that this may be in the interstitium or inside the tubule, we cannot be sure. So this is tubulitis. So for tubulitis, either we should look at the cross section of the tubule like this, or to count the invasion of lymphocyte to 10 cells. in the long, in if the tubule is long. If there is no invading lymphocyte, it is T0. If between 1 to 4 per the cross section of the tubule or per 10 tubular cell, it is T1, 1 to 4. 5 to 10, it is T2. Above 10, it is T3. So this is T1 because here this is invading lymphocyte. So it is, but the invasion is less than 4. It is here. So it is from 1 to 4, it is T1. And here you can count 6 cells. So it is tubulitis, T2. And here you can count many, many lymphocytes. It is T3. Again, this is T3. You can hear. You can here count many, many cells. This is an important. So for tubulitis, we have T0, T1, T2, T3. T0, no invasion of the tubular basement membrane by lymphocytes. T1, between 1 to 4. T2, 5 to 10. And above 10, it is T3. For vasculitis or vascular inflammation, this is V1, inflammation of the intimal here, but there is no narrowing of the blood vessel. It is V1. If there is narrowing up encroaching on 25% of the vessel lumen like this one, it is V2. And if there is transmural arthritis, all the wall of the vessel is invaded by inflammatory cells, it is V3. Sometimes we can find even fibrinoid necrosis, as you see in these vessels. So the to put all these together, this is the report of Banff 2017, and as I mentioned, there is no change in acute disseminated rejection in comparison to old ones. So to say grade 1 A rejection, before I'm going to speak about grade 1A, let us to start with suspicious borderline for acute disseminated rejection. If there is foci of tubulitis, means that T is above 0 with minor interstitial inflammation, I0 or 1, or moderate to severe interstitial inflammation, I2 or I3 with mild tubulitis, T1, retaining the I1 threshold for borderline with T above 0 is permitted, although this must be made transplant in transparent in the report and publication. Here I want to say, after knowing what's I, T, and V, we should look at if this I, the threshold for diagnosing grade 1 A rejection, is the presence of T2 plus I2. If there is no combination of T2 and I2, it is borderline rejection, as it is clear here in this table. So for grade 1A, interstitial inflammation involving more than 25%, this means T2, I2, of non-sclerotic cortical parenchyma, so I2, or even above 50% I3, with moderate tubulitis T2, involving one or more of tubules, not including tubules that are severely atrophic. So this is the criteria for grade 1A. The minimum criteria is T2 plus I2 or T2 plus I3. This is 1A. For 1B, interstitial inflammation involving more than 25%, this means I2 or I3, of non-sclerotic cortical parenchyma with severe tubulitis T3. So the only difference between 1B and 1A is the presence of T3 in 1B, involving one or more tubule, not including tubules that are severely atrophic. Regarding grade 2, if there is any vasculitis, the rejection is in grade 2. So mild to moderate intimal arthritis, V1, with or without interstitial inflammation or tubulitis, it is grade 2A. If there is severe intimal arthritis, V2, with or without interstitial inflammation, it is 2B. If there is V3, transmural arthritis, and or arterial fibrinoid necrosis of the medial smooth muscle with accompanying mononuclear cell intimal arthritis V3 with or without interstitial inflammation and or tibialitis, it is grade 3. Again, to diagnose grade 1 A rejection, we should have T2 plus I2 or I3. To say 1B, it should be T3 plus I2 or I3. For 2A, it is V1. If it is V2, it is grade 2B. V3 means a grade 3 rejection. And in grade 3 in the presence of vasculitis plus other components of antibody mediated rejection, so it may be due to antibody components or antibody mediated rejection. So before concluding the T cell mediated rejection, we should look at the other parameters of antibody mediated rejection, because sometimes we may have combined active T cell mediated rejection and antibody mediated rejection. Regarding active antibody mediated rejection, the theory of antibody mediated rejection, here we have antibodies that are against HLA antigens in this cartoon, and these antibodies will stimulate complement, and after activation of the complement, there will be cascade of inflammation and pathology leading to disruption of the graft. So this is antibody mediated, because antibodies drive the process of antibody mediated rejection. This was one of the terrible males of transplantation, hyperacute rejection, that after the incorporation of sophisticated immunological lab, we don't see hyperacute rejection. Here, the graft is thrombosed, and there is invading by inflammatory cell immediate after anastomosis. So this is hyperacute rejection. Regarding the antibody-mediated rejection, the term here, either active antibody-mediated rejection, here they omitted acute because they are not sure if it is acute onset or not. So active instead of acute. To say active antibody-mediated rejection, all three criteria must be met for diagnosis. What are these three criteria? Histological, so it is morphological appearance, evidence of current recent antibody interaction, and serological evidence of donor specific antibody or its surrogate markers. Let me to go step by step. For histological evidence of acute tissue injury, so acute tissue injury means active antibody mediated rejection. Chronic tissue injury, it is chronic antibody mediated rejection. So acute tissue injury including one or more of the following: microvascular inflammation, so these are the letters of antibody mediated rejection, G above zero, and I'll show you the how to score the G means glomerulitis, or BTC, peritubular capillaritis, above zero. In the absence of recurrent or de novo glomerulonephritis, although in the presence of acute T cell mediated rejection, borderline infiltrate or infection, BTC above or equal one alone is not sufficient and must be more than one. Intimal or transmural arthritis, this is the second criteria. So we may have microvascular inflammation, intimal or transmural arthritis, acute thrombotic microangiopathy in the absence of any other cause, acute tubular injury in the absence of any other apparent cause. So the morphology of active antibody mediated rejection is one of four criteria: either microvascular inflammation, G or BTC, glomerulitis or peritubular capillaritis; secondly, intimal arthritis; third, acute thrombotic microangiopathy; fourth, acute tubular injury. To diagnose, we should have one of these for fulfilling the morphological criteria. The second criteria is evidence of current or recent antibody interaction with vascular endothelium, including one or more of the following: linear C4D staining. And linear is very important because we may find granular staining in lupus, for example. So linear C4D staining in the peritubular capillaries, C4D, and this is the third letter, so G, BTC, and now C4D, and I'll comment on C4D later. C4D 2 or 3 by immune fluorescence on frozen section, or C4D more than 0 by immune histochemical staining on paraffin section. This is very important. So C4D 0 means no staining for C4D. It is absent, negative, completely negative. If it is between, it is above 0 to 10%, it is minimal, or C4D 1. From 10 to 50, it is focal, and it is C4D 2. Above 50, it is C4D 3. All these criteria are based on the immune fluorescence. Usually, immune histochemical is downgrading the staining by step. This is why here C4D 2 and 3, or 3 by immune fluorescence, or above, just above 0 by immune histochemical staining. At least moderate microvascular inflammation, the sum of G glomerulitis plus BTC equal or exceed 2, in the absence of glomerulonephritis, either de novo or recurrent, although in the presence of acute disseminated rejection, borderline infiltrate or infection, BTC above or equal to alone is not sufficient, and G must be above or equal 1. Increase the expression. This is the third one, and this is the new addition in the BAMF. Increase the expression of gene transcripts or classifiers in the biopsy tissue is strongly associated with antibody meat rejection if thoroughly validated in different centers. So this is the second criteria. First criteria is morphology. Second criteria is interaction. Third criteria, serologic evidence of donor-specific antibodies are either against HLA or other antigens. C4D staining or expression of validated transcripts or classifier, as noted above in criterion 2 here, may substitute for DSA. And this is a real new addition, and it is logical, because C4D, if there is a staining of, by C4D, usually antibody print is there. However, thorough DSA testing, including testing for non-HLA antibodies, if HLA antibody testing is negative, is strongly advised whenever criteria 1 and 2 are met. So, to conclude, for active antibody meat rejection, acute antibody meat rejection is omitted. Acute is omitted, and it's replaced by active antibody meat rejection. To diagnose active antibody mediated rejection, we should investigate for the presence of three criteria. One morphologic criteria, one criteria for the evidence of current or recent antibody interaction, and the serology for DSA. If we, for sometimes if we have morphology, G plus BTC exceeding 2, with positive C4D, these criteria are enough for diagnosis of active antibody mediated rejection based on the new BAMF report. This is the glomerulitis. Here, the capillaries of the glomeruli are full of inflammation. To score glomerulitis, we may have no glomerulitis, or G1 glomerulitis is less than 25% of glomeruli, or glomerulitis, global glomerulitis in 25 to 75% of the glomeruli, or G3 glomerulitis, mostly global in more than 75% of the glomeruli. This is how we score glomerulitis. And this is acute tubular injury that denotes the morphology of antibody immediate rejection. This is the third BTC, microvascular inflammation. So microvascular inflammation is glomerulitis or peritubular capillaries. Here, this is the tubules, and this is the peritubular capillaries. Peritubular capillaries here are full of inflammatory cells. So to say peritubular capillaries, at least 10% of the capillaries, peritubular capillaries, are inflamed with inviable cortex. This is the, to say there is peritubular capillaries. How to grade? We have BTC1. This means that the cells within the peritubular capillaries are less than 5. If 5 to 10, it is BTC2. If it's above 10 cells, it is BTC3. So this is peritubular capillaritis, here as you see in this slide. This is a linear staining. Again, it's C4D. This is for peritoneal capillaries. Here, this is the tubules negative. And here, between the tubule, there is linear staining by against C4D by immune fluorescence. So this is C4D. This is from Professor Helmutrenki. If you look here, this is the there is no staining for the peritoneal capillaries, but here all the peritoneal capillaries are linearly stained against C4D. So this is C4D3 and this is C4D0. This is immunohistochemical staining showing the linear staining against C4D. So it again. The C4D staining. This is regarding active antibody mediated rejection. So what about chronic antibody mediated rejection? Chronic antibody mediated rejection is very important and crucial in the current era of transplantation because the majority of graft failure based on this study and other experience is related to antibody mediated rejection. More than 50% of the cases are due to chronic antibody mediated rejection. The components, the letters for in the active antibody mediated rejection, I mentioned morphological changes. This is the discriminatory between active and chronic because the evidence for interaction with endothelium and the presence of anti-HLA antibodies or other non-HLA antibodies in the sera or the transcripts are common between active and chronic antibody mediated rejection. But the morphology in chronic active and chronic antibody mediated rejection is different. Here you can see double contouring appearance. It is crystal clear here. The double thickening of the vas membrane of the glomeruli of the glomerulus. So this is TG transplant glomerulopathy. And here this is the remodeling by electron microscope. And if you look here for peritoneal capillary, here this is the thin layers. Here multilayering is evident. And here more and more multilayering. So sometimes we pick up the multilayering by electron microscope before it appears in the light microscope. So for diagnosing chronic antibody mediated rejection, we depend upon transplant glomerulopathy or multilayering of peritoneal capillaries. So the diagnosis of chronic antibody mediated rejection includes three criteria. Morphologic evidence of chronic tissue injury, including one or more, transplant glomerulopathy, CG, this is a letter CG, above zero, if no evidence of chronic thrombotic macroangiopathy or chronic recurrent de novo glomerulonephritis, all these should be considered. If the changes is apparent only by electron microscope, it is CG1A. Severe peritoneal capillary basement membrane multilayering, it require electron microscope. Arterial intimal fibrosis of new onset, so the intravascular compartment, there is chronicity in the form of arterial intimal fibrosis of new onset, excluding other causes, leukocyte within the sclerotic intima, favor chronic antibody mediated rejection if there is no prior history of endothelial mediated rejection but are not required. So the diagnostic criteria regarding the morphology, we may depend upon transplant glomerulopathy or the multilayering of peritoneal capillaries or intimal fibrosis. Then the second and third criteria are identical to active antibody mediated rejection. Here, within the BAMF 2017, there is the diagnosis C4D staining without evidence of rejection. All four criteria must be fulfilled. Linear C4D staining in the peritoneal capillaries. Criterion 1 for active antibody mediated rejection is absent. No molecular evidence for antibody mediated rejection. No acute or chronic active T-cell mediated rejection or borderline changes. To say just C4D staining, and I think it needs to be followed up later on. So this is the criteria of the PAMF. Regarding chronic active T-cell mediated rejection, the PAMF 2017 added the term chronic active T-cell mediated rejection. So here we have grade 1A, 1B, and grade 2. In chronic active T-cell mediated rejection, we have EFTA, if the means interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy, plus inflammation, plus tubulitis. So interstitial inflammation involving more than 25% of the total cortex. Here, total cortex, because this includes the scarred and the viable part. T1 score 2 or 3, and above 25% of sclerotic cortical parenchyma, IFTA score 2 or 3, with moderate tubulitis, T2 involving one or more tubules, not including severely atrophic tubules. Other known causes of IFTA should be ruled out. So this is to diagnose grade 1A. Grade 1A means IFTA plus tubulitis. Tubulitis T2. If it is T3, interstitial inflammation and tubular atrophy, so interstitial inflammation involving more than 25% of the total cortex and more than 25% of sclerotic cortical parenchyma, IFTA score 2 or 3, with severe tubulitis T3, involving one or more of tubules, not including severely atrophic tubules, other known causes of IFTA should be ruled out. So the difference between 1A and 1B is the presence of T2 or T3. So IFTA plus T2 means grade 1A, 1A, IFTA plus T3 means 1B. Grade 2, chronic allograft arteriopathy, interstitial intimal fibrosis with mononuclear cell inflammation in fibrosis and formation of new intimal. If you look here, this is the histology of tubular atrophy and interstitial fibrosis. And here there is tubulitis T2 within, this is T2. So it is here, this is grade 1. This is chronic active T-cell mediated rejection 1A. And here you can find here tubulitis even more and more. So it is one, it is T3, so it is 1B. So for this and this, it is grade 1A, chronic active T-cell mediated rejection, and here it is 1B. Regarding nephrotoxicity of calcium inhibitors, before I'm going to speak about the calcium inhibitor, if you find this is acute tubular injury. Because here the lining of the lining is atrophic and there is debris within the renal tubules and dilatation of the tubules, so this is acute tubular injury. If we find acute tubular injury, this should be put in mind, because it may be one of the criteria of active antibody mediated rejection, or may be related to hypovolemia or sepsis or other causes like native kidney. For calcium inhibitor nephrotoxicity, we may find here, as you see, vacuolization. So this is isometric vacuolization of renal tubules that signals acute calcium inhibitor-related nephrotoxicity. And this is one from our patients. Here you can find, you can look at the vacuolization of the tubules. Again, vacuolization of the tubules, or thrombotic microangiopathy induced by calcium inhibitor. And this is the thrombotic microangiopathy here, within the tissue. This is very interesting. Look at this bus stain, and here you can find nodular hyalinosis of the vessel, starting from the adventitia and affecting the media. So this is medial hyalinosis of the vessel, nodular hyalinosis of the vessel. And this is by silver staining, showing the same nodular medial hyalinosis. To differentiate between hypertension-related hyalinosis, hypertension-related hyalinosis starts within the intima, but here the hyalinosis starting with the adventitial side of the media, so it is related to calcineurin inhibitors. So for calcineurin inhibitors, we have either vacuolization, thrombotic microangiopathy, and here hyalinosis of the vessels, and this is stripped fibrosis by methotrexate. You can find here, this is fibrosis, so this may be related to calcium inhibitors. Other diagnosis, I mentioned already acute tubular injury, so we should think of acute tubular injury, because the diagnosis of the acute allograft dysfunction may include acute tubular injury like native kidney, the pre-renal, renal, and post-renal, and it's not restricted only to active and acute T-cell mid rejection, active antibody mid rejection, or chronic antibody mid rejection, or chronic T-cell mediated rejection, we may have acute liver injury, acute liver necrosis, and other diagnoses like as inhibitor nephrotoxicity. And this is the recurrence, this collapsing variety of focal and segmental glomerulosclerosis. You can find here the cell within the pulmonary space. And this is the specimen examined under polarized light. You can see here the oxalate crystal. So this is recurrent oxalosis. What is this? This is the patient who presents with acute allograft dysfunction, and a graft biopsy reveals the presence of inflammation within the tubules. All tubules are full of neutrophils. So this is neutrophil cast denoting acute pyelonephritis of the graft. And this by higher magnification. The neutrophils within the lumen, it is acute pyelonephritis of the graft. And we may find other issues within the graft biopsy like this. Here you can find here internuclear inclusion bodies within the here, within the tubular segments. And this is after staining by SCV40. You can find positive staining within the intranuclear inclusion bodies. So it is BK virus nephropathy, and this is the criteria of the inclusion intranuclear inclusions by electron microscope. And currently, this month, there is the BAMF working group classification of definitive bulimia virus nephropathy, morphologic definitions and clinical correlations. And the significant statement of this article is bulimia virus nephropathy, BVN, is a significant infectious complication of kidney transplants. Currently, bulimia virus nephropathy diagnosed in a renal biopsy is not further subclassified, and the impact of morphologic bulimia virus nephropathy variants on graft function is poorly understood. The reported multicenter study addresses these classification needs. It is based on the largest cohort of patients with bulimia virus nephropathy systematically analyzed thus far. The study defines three morphologic bulimia virus nephropathy classes using interstitial fibrosis and intrarenal bulimia virus load levels are statistically verified class denominators. It describes class one as an early bulimia virus nephropathy stage with favorable outcome, and class two and three as having more pronounced impact on graft on the function, with graft failure rates reaching 50% in class three. The proposed classification aims at improving clinical pathological correlation and the comparability of studies. A simple biopsy diagnosis of bulimia virus nephropathy no longer suffices. And this is how they categorize. So looking at the score and the presence of chronic interstitial fibrosis, you can follow to know how the classification is done. To conclude, for diagnosis of renal allograft dysfunction, we need clinical sense, laboratory evaluation, and biopsy. These are the cornerstones. For laboratory evaluation, we have biochemical, hematological, and immunological workup after transplantation. And the most important point in the pathology diagnosis, we should read in details the report, not only the conclusion of the report. And the most important way is to communicate with the pathologist. And all nephrologists working in the field of transplantation should be aware of the terminology and should be acquainted with the morphologic appearance of the biopsies. So I encourage all colleagues and myself to discuss the cases with the pathologist and to see the pathological finding with them to take the sense of the allograft function. At the end of the day, the person who is responsible of diagnosis and management is a transplant nephrologist. And at the end, I would like to thank you very much for your good attention, and I'll be happy if you send me any questions. Thank you. Goodbye.